Good morning, good afternoon to everyone. As you know, that the topic for our today's webinar is Indonesian Transfer Pricing Alert, and this is in specific reference to Action 13. So I'll take you through what contents we're going to be covering in this presentation. As we know, that Action 13 has become very crucial for MNEs across the globe, and Action 13 was delivered by the OECD as part of the final BEPS package in October 15. And this Action 13 requires companies to have country-by-country reporting in place, master file, and local file. And when we look at where are the countries on this Action 13, we have a mixed response in Asia. For example, countries like India, Malaysia, and Singapore, they are still in completion stage of implementing or putting all parts of Action 13 into the legislation. And there are other countries like Indonesia, Japan, which have reflected the full Action 13 into their legislation. And which means that the corporates, they have to comply with the rules under Action 13. So our today webinar will be covering what documentation requirements Action 13 expects from MNEs in Indonesia, and we will also talk about how those requirements align with Action Plan 13 by the OECD. And another thing we would share with you is that what are the deadlines to comply with, and if those deadlines are not complied, then what implications the MNEs will have to face in Indonesia. And at the end of this web event, the MNE will know what impact it will have if it doesn't comply with the Action 13 requirements, and what are steps the MNE has to take to comply with Action 13 requirements in Indonesia. And which means that it's not only country by country reporting, but also master file, local file. And in one way, it can give some certainty to taxpayer in Indonesia, which means that there are clear guidance available now. But at the same time, it will give some level of information to tax authorities to pick up cases where they find that if there's any misalignment between the information in three different layers of documentation, which is country-by-country reporting, master file, and local file. So MNE has to keep that in mind. If there are any anomalies, red flags, they have to be addressed in advance before the case is picked up for scrutiny in Indonesia. So with this background, I give the floor to my colleague Graham, who will take you through the specific facts of Action 13 in the light of how it has been implemented and into regulation in Indonesia. Graham, please.
Thank you, Virender, and good morning, good afternoon, perhaps good evening to MB. Maybe previous slide, please. Yeah. So, yeah, following on from how Virender introduced, I'd just like to maybe focus firstly on the way in which the regulations introduced in Indonesia represent an expansion of the scope and a fairly aggressive timetable. We'll go on to see what sort of risks there might be to MNEs who don't comply with these rules. And we'll look through some of the requirements, all of the requirements actually, and just highlight some of the differences between what's in the regulations now and what might have been expected previously or what might be expected in accordance with Action Plan 13, and what flexibility may apply and what steps MNEs might want to try and take to meet these new requirements. Next slide, please. So just before moving on, this is actually a quote from the last webinar that I did for TPA, I said that the BEPS implementation may be expected earlier in Indonesia. I think what we're seeing is that Indonesia is applying the most aggressive timetable it possibly could in accordance with the BEPS action plan agreed. Next slide, please. So firstly, we just look at in what way are these regulations expanding the scope and accelerating the timetable. Next slide. So basically, just a summary of what criteria might trigger the requirements to have both the master file and the local file in place. And I think, without doing an overall comparison, I believe that some of these criteria may be slightly lower than would be expected. Revenues of equivalent of $3.7 million. Values of goods, so actual physical flows of goods of $1.4 million, are probably the most interesting. The last two are the threshold of 370,000 payments between related parties for services, interest, or royalties, or any other types of non-physical goods transactions, and the fact that the counterparty is in a country where the tax rate is less than the Indonesian tax rate of 25%. And it's worth noting that 78 countries have been identified by the Indonesian tax office as falling into this latter category. And another, aside from the fact that the requirements now apply to a lower threshold than previously, there is now no distinction between cross-border transactions and domestic transactions. So I think what we're looking at is a huge expansion of the types and number of entities who are now having to fulfill these requirements. And it's also worth noting that there's an expectation that the arm's length price is being followed regardless of whether these thresholds are reached or not.
Graham, don't you think that when we look at these thresholds, for example, for value of other transaction, it's $370K. US dollar, don't you think are these thresholds too low? Would that mean that a lot of companies will be covered in Indonesia?
I certainly think that it's a huge expansion of the of scope in terms of the number of companies it applies to. They would appear to be too low, but I think it's an indication, along with other things that have been happening in Indonesia, of an attempt to really widen the net and try and capture as many entities and taxpayers into the tax paying thresholds as possible, and to make sure that all taxpayers are considering their related party transactions and documenting them in a serious manner.
Yeah.
Okay. So the consequences, if you have said yes in relation to any of those questions or criteria in relation to your Indonesian entity, then a master file and a local file is required to be available by the 30th of April this year. That's assuming a December year end, because the requirement relates to the filing of an annual tax return, just 4 months after the year end. Another expansion, I think, or another change to the scope is that it's now required to be in the Indonesian language, Bahasa Indonesia. Previously, there was no specific requirement for Indonesian language documentation. So at the very least, even companies who have full documentation in place are going to have to consider a technical translation of that documentation so that they can comply. And the consequence of not complying is that you're potentially facing an audit and a 50% fine on the findings. There are some circumstances in which that fine may be lower, but that's definitely one of the potentials, and we'll go through some of the detail later on this. And a breach occurs based on the filing, so when you actually submit your tax return, if you have not been able to complete the documentation, or complete the summary that says that you have the documentation, then you're in breach. And you know, subsequently, if you are requested to produce the documentation and you cannot, then you're in breach. And in the case of whether if the documentation is either not there or submitted late, there's a potential that the tax office would deem the amount that's underpaid based on their own analysis. So fairly serious stuff. Next slide, please. So this is just a representation of the form that needs to be submitted with the annual tax return for 2016. It's slightly compressed, but basically just to give you to familiarize those who will have to deal with this with the form. It's the official one is in Bahasa Indonesia, but this is the English representation. We'll go through each of these sections in a little bit of detail. Next slide, please.
And Graham, when we look at this master file, we know that OECD has given a specific format, and a group will be preparing one master file which will be used in different countries. But when it goes to the signing of this master file for submission in Indonesia, I can see that a taxpayer has to sign it. So will that need to be signed by the head office, or will that need to be signed by some local signatory in Indonesian entity?
Well, the signature here is in relation to the submission of the local tax return. So it would need to be a local official of the taxpayer, the Indonesian taxpayer, or their designated representative, which would usually be a registered tax consultant. Next slide, please. So, a little bit more detail about the consequences. Scenarios that we're looking at here. The first one, if you don't submit the summary, which is that document on the previous slide, then the annual tax return, which is known as the SPT, will be rejected. The initial consequence of that is that you will receive a small fine, it's less than $100, but you will then receive a warning letter requesting that you submit the complete documentation, which includes this summary, and you may then be, you may then be triggered for a potential audit. It's not clear either how long you will have to submit that. Usually we would say it'd be 30 days, but that's not been specifically legislated in this circumstance. And I think there's always the possibility that having been put on the list by not submitting a full documentation in terms of the tax return, then you're probably possibly going to be on an audit list anyway. And you will then be subject, once you are audited, the fine for the underpayment, the 50% of that underpayment. If you are subsequently requested to submit documentation and do not, then the assessment will be subject to a further 50% fine. Again, that assessment will be based on the basically a deemed assessment from the tax office. They should, in theory, go through due process to come up with what they believe to be arm's length pricing for transactions, but you know, experience shows that that's not necessarily always the case. The third scenario is where you are late with submission of the documentation. In such cases, the TP documentation would just be considered to be information and not fully used in any assessment which is made. So potentially you're looking at a similar situation to not having documentation at all. And this, the only difference in this case would be that the penalty is 2% per month. So depending on timing, you could be looking at substantially less than a 50% fine, but it's still a fairly onerous proposition, I think.
And Graham, there are a few countries like in Asia, for example, my experience in India has been that their penalties are quite substantial. So, for example, if documentation is not completed, they had 2% penalty of the value of international transactions. But for non-submission of CBCR and master file, local file, they have a fixed amount penalty. So when I look at this 50% fine, this may be substantial if it is on the value of transaction. So I want to know that this 50% is applied on what base?
Okay, again, based on the assessment, which would be the additional tax payable based on whatever the tax office deemed to be the underpayment when they calculate their own arm's length pricing on the transactions.
Okay.
The final scenario, I think final broad scenario, is that where they believe that the documentation is not prepared on an ex ante or contemporaneous basis, then they would not consider that to be representative arm's length pricing, and again raise an assessment and apply a fine. In that case, it would be back to the 2% per month rather than the 50%. So therefore, if you don't submit the summary, you should expect a warning followed by a potential audit. And if the documentation has not been prepared and therefore is not available within a specified time period, then you could expect that there will be a deemed assessment. So they will not consider the documentation that you have prepared. And it should be noted that such a request for documentation may have a time period of as little as 14 days. Next slide, please. Next slide. Previous. So the it's also worth noting that there's the country. These reports are required by the end of this year, based on breaching the criteria as of 2016. So these being quite similar to the levels in Action Plan 13, 11 trillion rupiah equates to about $830 million, and I suppose around not too far from the euro figure quoted in Action Plan 13. But importantly, I haven't proposed to go into any detail in the country-by-country reporting because it's not such an immediate requirement, although obviously there will be a lot of work needed to be done between now and the end of the year. I think in most cases that will be already in hand. But importantly, that those cases where it may not be in hand is that the Indonesian taxpayer, which is a member of a group which breaches the criteria, but where the documentation would not be available to Indonesian tax office in any other means, then the Indonesian taxpayer has the obligation to submit that country by country reporting. I think in the OECD action plan that kind of scenario is effectively presented as an election, whereas in Indonesian regulations, it's a stipulation that they're expecting that all Indonesian taxpayers, where they wouldn't otherwise be available, those Indonesian taxpayers have the obligation to make that available to the Indonesian tax office.
And Grab, there's one question from the audience before we move to the next section. The question is that does the master file prepared at group level centrally have to also be translated into Indonesian language?
I believe yes. There's no specific exemption or concession given, so I believe yes, that's the very minimum. You'll have to translate the master file.
Okay, and then the next question is that what happens with the summary file if the taxpayer intends to file a draft to obtain a two-month extension? Does the taxpayer submit the summary form with the draft return in April?
It's a good question. I'm not sure that's been addressed. I did see that question coming up somewhere else, but I'm not sure that issue has been addressed. I believe that the deadline of April is fairly fixed in terms of their expectation at the moment. It may be that there will be further regulations issued to cover these kind of issues or to give some sort of leeway. But at the moment, it would seem that as of the 30th of April, you need to submit this this summary.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, next slide. So let's look at what actually do they require to be reported. Next slide. Again, this is another copy of the actual summary. And at that level, most things I think are fairly standard and what you would maybe expect to see as in accordance with Action Plan 13. The main thing I think to focus on there is that the fact that they the third section there requires that the date of availability is stated, and in the context of the rest of it, it's fairly clear that the document is already been prepared when entering the transaction. So it's antique. Next slide. So maybe just to give you a little bit more of easier to read in terms of each section. You know, the master file, as you would probably expect, you know, showing the ownership structure, the business activities, intangible assets owned, and the financial activities and financing, plus the consolidated financial statements. Fairly standard in accordance with Action Plan 13. Next slide.
And Raham, one thing which is concerning taxpayers across the globe is that the taxpayer has to provide the value chain of the business, and which has to be part of the master file, where one has to show what profits are being earned by different pockets of the value chain. Is that also a requirement in master file in Indonesia as well?
Well, we'll go through the detail of each of these sections, and in terms of that specific question, I think there's nothing that specifically says the value chain, but as you'll see later with the detail, pretty much the same information is probably required in a slightly different way.
Okay.
So again, also in the local file summary, you know, the requirements at the high level look to be fairly standard in accordance with Action Plan 13, possibly with the exception of the last one there being that they're also asking for non-financial factors which may influence prices or profit levels. But you know, nothing further on that. Next slide. And again, just to emphasize that this third section is to basically state that when you submit the summary, you already have the documentation available, and that it was prepared on an ex ante basis. Just to remind you before we go into any of the detail about what the requirements are, answered yes to any of the criteria questions which were set out earlier on, then you need to submit the master file and the local file by 4 months after the year end or the financial year end, and it must be in Indonesian language, or you face potential audit, and sometimes that could lead to an additional 50% fine on whatever findings arise from that audit. Next slide, please. Okay, so let's go through each of those high-level requirements in detail. In terms of the master file, the first requirement to have an ownership structure, I think fairly standard requirement, but in the detailed requirements that are set out in the legislation in Indonesia, part of that they require is a register of shareholders and a percentage holding, and a list of board members, which I think is going into a little bit more detail than was anticipated in the action plan. The other two listed requirements of having the overall relationship and the geographical location are fairly standard. But I can see some potential problems with the level of detail required of shareholders and board members. next slide. In the second section, all fairly standard or in accordance with Action Plan 13, these requirements, with the probable exception of the last requirement in that any restructuring, acquisition, divestiture that's been undertaken. I think the Action Plan 13 mentioned within the last year, and Indonesia it requires it within the last 5 years. Next slide. In terms of the intangible assets detail required, I believe it's all pretty much in aligned with the requirements set out in Action Plan 13, in Annex 1 of Action Plan 13. and it's perhaps a little surprising to us here that they haven't actually expanded on this any more than is detailed in Action Plan 13, as intangibles have been one of the major areas corrected over the last few years in tax audits. So it's perhaps interesting that they've followed almost word for word what the OECD says, and perhaps that indicates that they believe that OECD has gone far enough in listing the requirements. Next slide. So financial activities and financing is fairly aligned with Annex 1 of Action Plan 13. So no major surprises there. Next slide. And again, the final requirement in terms of the master plan is the consolidated financial statements, which and list of any APAs or other tax issues which are pertinent to the allocation of income amongst the group. Again, aligned with Action Plan 13, Annex 1. Next slide. Yeah. Okay. In terms of the local file requirements and the comparison with Annex 2, I think reasonably well aligned with the action with Annex 2, but perhaps in slightly more detail, some of the operational aspects and a description of the business environment, which is perhaps in addition to what has been listed in Annex 2. Next slide. So in terms of the detail on the transactions, I think one thing to highlight is this: the second point there in the detail section is pricing policies which have been applied in the last 5 years is substantially more detail than has been recommended in Annex 2 to Action Plan 13. And again, in the table down towards the bottom of that slide, the table showing that level of detail, I think again is a lot more detailed than has been set out in Action Plan 13. So again, they're going into a lot more granularity in their requirements. It may be that documentation that's currently in place may need to be tweaked to include these kind of additional requirements. Next slide. So again, the actual application of the arm's length principle, most of the requirements are reasonably aligned with Annex 2. I think the possibly the one to focus on here in terms of any difference is the second point in the detail section there, is a detailed explanation of the business characteristic based on the function, asset, and risk analysis. That aligns with the current requirements on in Indonesia on tax audit transfer pricing documentation, where you have to basically select a category of entity from a defined list. You know, for example, fully fledged manufacturer, limited risk distributor, etc. And I've always felt that this kind of forces taxpayers to be put in a box where they're not necessarily fully aligned with that kind of characteristic, and the danger would be that if having been put in that box or claiming that you're in that box, the comparables that may be used may not be appropriate. So I think next slide. This is a continuation of the application of the arm's length principle, and I think again the most important thing to focus on that it's perhaps not quite aligned with expectations from Action Plan 13 is a segmentation of financial information where the taxpayer has more than one line of business. As far as I can see, that's not specifically mentioned in Action Plan 13 or the annex, but this has been a requirement under the Indonesian regulations for some time, principally requirement that that focuses on situations where taxpayers are being audited. So when you get audited here, the information required for transfer pricing purposes becomes a lot more extensive than the general. Okay, next slide, please. So finally on the arm's length principle is there's a conclusion of whether or not the transfer pricing documentation shows that pricing is in accordance with the arm's length principle. I don't think that's controversial in any way, but maybe just a little bit of a extra level of confirmation. Next slide. So again, and that's the second bullet point in the detailed section there, slightly different spelling, I'm afraid, but segmented financial reports based on line of business are required. So aligned pretty much with Action Plan 13 Annex 2 requirements, but the segmentation is perhaps a slight extension. Next slide. And finally, I think this slight addition to the requirements in that any factors that might have affected the price or profitability of the entity but are not directly financially related should be included within the local file. Next slide. So just going back to emphasize once again that the statement that taxpayers are making when filing their corporate income tax return and saying that they have master file and local file, that they've already available. So it's unlikely, I believe, that you can state some date in the future when you believe that your documentation will be completed. And they will accept that as being as being in accordance with these regulations. The principal focus is on the ex ante or the contemporaneous nature of the of the documentation. So next slide, please. So question, I guess, is there any? These are fairly aggressive requirements, and the question we have put to the tax officials is, you know, well, you know, is there any way in which there's going to be some flexibility in those question earlier on about whether you can get an extension to the submission of tax returns and whether this will be aligned. They've told us verbally that the implementation may be flexible, but the expectation is that all MNEs already have in place most of this documentation, and it's just a question of collating it and putting it into ensuring that the master and local files are available in accordance with these requirements. You know, another comment that's come back from the tax office is that they believe everything can be achievable with some hard work. So there's not a great deal of appreciation of what's actually going on within MNEs around the world in trying to comply with various different requirements from different jurisdictions. But this Indonesian tax office set out their stall and expect people to comply. So although verbally they've said that it may be flexible, and we yet to see any evidence of that, the current legislation would seem to give the power to the tax office and put the burden onto the taxpayers to get all documentation in aligned and compliant within the next few months. It's definitely possible that there will be some revisions or clarifications come out in relation to this legislation, but nothing's certain at the moment, nothing guaranteed. Next slide, please. So in conclusion, before hopefully we can take some questions, it's fairly clear now that it's necessary to have a contemporaneous documentation, and that should be on a transaction by transaction basis, or at least a group of transactions. There's an aggressive expansion of the scope, because a lot of companies which previously would not have been included, would not have a requirement to prepare transfer pricing documentation, will now find that they do have that requirement, and the consequences of not complying could be fairly severe. So you know, everyone has to consider whether it's possible to meet the deadline. So I think just as a practical step, you know, any current documentation that is available, whether that's at master file level or local file level or in another jurisdiction, should be used to the extent possible to be able to basically tick the box that yes, we have complied, we have got the information available. Always bearing in mind that if the taxpayer concern does find themselves subject to tax audit, that by that stage, it's fairly crucial that you have sufficient documentation to justify why you have said that the documentation was available, but also to defend the position in the case of any potential adjustment by the tax office. So any beta versions of master files, for example, should possibly be considered for use, whilst at the same time looking at making sure that going forward everything's being prepared on an ex ante basis. So yeah, there may be a need to revisit what the M&E's policy is and whether their timetables globally are going to allow for compliance with these requirements. And if you cannot do it on the basis of the global actions that are being taken, then the local, you need to be prepared that the local entity may be subject to adjustment. And at the same time, noting that aside from these immediate requirements, the country-by-country reporting needs to be in place by the end of this year. So I think that's a very brief summary of the impact or what's included in these new regulations and the potential impact. Happy to take any questions that anyone has.
Thanks, Raham. We already have a few questions in the chat box, and there are a few people who have raised their hands, so I request them to put their questions in the chat box so that we can take the questions. Graham, one question we have from the audience is that when the deadline for the master file in the country of the ultimate parent is set at a much later date than the Indonesian deadline, does the Indonesian deadline of April 30th still apply?
At this stage, there is nothing to provide any concession to such a situation. So I would say that yes, the answer is yes. There's an expectation. I think, as I mentioned in verbal discussions with the tax office, they do have this expectation that globally M&Es already have policies and documentation to support those policies on a global basis, and that this is not such a big step for them to take. So for those entities which do not yet have anything in place at a head office or a more central level.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks. The next question, which also somewhere relates to the deadline, is that if parent has different financial year and, example, March end, how do they imagine submission of consolidated statements and other up-to-date information for the year if parent is only closing the financial year at the time of Indonesian deadline? I think this is also the same question, that if the parent has a different deadline, for example, for completing their consolidated accounts, then if that deadline is different from the deadline in Indonesia, then how should they comply with Indonesian requirements?
Yeah, again, that's not specifically included in any of the legislation so far. It may be that some of the implementing regulations or further clarifications that come out may provide some guidance on that, but at this stage it would appear that the expectation is that everything is available prior to filing of the tax return.
Yeah, okay, thanks. The next question we have is that since the summary form provides for the date for master file and local file are ready, can the taxpayer submit in April but put the dates of the files are ready by June, for example?
I think the risk of that would be that it may then be considered that the documentation was not prepared on an ex ante basis, rather ex post, and in that circumstance, as I say, you know, according to the current wording of the legislation, it could be that the documentation is not fully considered and the taxpayer would be subject to adjustment. Again, you know, it may be that we will get some clarification and some relaxation of that, but at this stage that would appear to be the case. Maybe it's worth noting that number one, that the tax office in Indonesia is quite frequently issues fairly what would appear to be fairly harsh legislation and then backtracks a little bit when there's an outcry. But number two, in the context of the current approach being taken and the current attempts to expand the tax base, it may be that the position that they're taking at the moment is not going to sway very much, because they're saying, well, our we've already given warning. There's been requirements in place for a number of years for taxpayers to have TP documentation in certain circumstances, and in their view, this is just a slight adjustment to align with OECD Action Plan 13.
Okay. Rob, next question we have is on control from parents to the entity in Indonesia, and the question is that how control is defined in a local regulation to be regarded as a related party if not meeting the shareholding interest?
Right. This is an issue which is not that well defined. The sort of catch-all definition of a related party is where there is control through management or technology, but that's not really very well defined. So there is a possibility that in a lot of circumstances the tax office could claim that there is a related relationship between the parties, even where the shareholding has not been breached. I'm not aware to what extent that's been used, although I do know that they are using it in the context of what you call a nominee type arrangement, which is quite common in Indonesia, where foreign ownership is not permitted or not permitted beyond a certain level in a local company, but the foreign entity still maintains some form of control of the operations, then that would in many cases be deemed to be a related party relationship. But again, it's not very well defined. But there is a potential that any kind of management or, let's say, use of technology. So if the local entity is dependent on a technology from overseas or IP from overseas, then there's certainly a potential that it would be deemed to be a related party.
Yeah, thanks, Ram. Perhaps another question on shareholding we have is that if there's a significant minority position in the local company in Indonesia, how do we handle that in the master file local file? Do you eliminate any transactions there might be with such minority shareholder?
Do eliminate? Well, it's that's not specifically mentioned in any of the legislation. I think if you're in a position where that is possible in other jurisdictions and it's a standard practice by the MNE, then and it's to your advantage, then there's nothing to prevent that happening. But it's not a position that's specifically legislated.
Because my experience, I spent a few years in India, and whenever we had minority shareholders which were below the threshold, then we did not include the analysis of those transactions because the law doesn't require. But I do agree with you that if you have transactions which are becoming part of master file, and if everything is fine, still it doesn't create much problem from a risk perspective to disclosing it.
Yeah, I mean, certainly I would agree that there should be no specific requirement to document those transactions. I took the question to be, do you adjust the financials to take account of those types of transactions? But I think if the question is in relation to whether there's a requirement to document those, then I would say no, there's no specific requirement if the minority shareholder is not deemed to be a related party for any other reason.
Okay, thanks. And the last question we have is on translation, and it says that translation in itself takes time, and we estimate 1 month, is there any room to have the English version ready for by the end of April, and then local language later?
Again, not specifically regulated. The only, I think, concession, so to speak, would be that where in certain circumstances where the taxpayer has been given the approval to keep records in foreign currency and English language, then they will accept English language documentation, but they still need a translation of that English language documentation. So again, at the moment, it's not there would appear to be no real concession, but I would think that in the case of in that kind of circumstance, I would think that there's a fairly high likelihood that kind of scenario might have some flexibility. So if you can show that you've got the documentation, it's just a question of getting it translated, then I don't think that should be a major problem or a major breach of the regulations.
Okay. Thanks, Ram. So we have covered all questions, and the last point asked by the audience is if the copy of presentation will be available for the audience. Yes, we will be posting this webinar, including presentation, on our website, and you can access this presentation from there. So that's all, Graham. Any final point you want to add?
No, I think that's it. Yeah, it's a fairly onerous proposition at the moment, but I can say the Indonesian tax office point of view, it's they don't feel as if it's too beyond the realm of possibility to comply.
Yeah, and Graham, I would see that the next stage will be how the tax authorities in Indonesia will take this information and initiate audit proceedings, because in few emerging markets there were long-standing TP issues, like on intangible creation, on some guarantee fees, other financial services transaction, medical service charge. Intangible has been something which is quite burning topic, so I think time will tell in which areas the tax audit will pick up once the Indonesian tax authorities, they will have a lot of information coming through master file and country by country reporting in time.
Yeah, I certainly think that it's fairly clear that they're going to be using a lot of this data to drive their strategy for audits and focus on particular transactions. In a way, it may be an improvement on the past, because there was never that much risk analysis done in terms of who was audited or who suffered the worst scenarios. Yeah, definitely they're going to be using this, and I think we're entering the big data era in the tax field.
Okay. So thanks, Graham, for your time. We also thank the audience for their patient listening, and some good questions were asked during the session today. So we look forward to connecting with the audience during our next webinar, which you will get invite soon. So I thank all of you again.